Time to meet today's guest, and what a lineup. First up, he's been a judge, a gently, and a professional, and made a career out of crime. Martin Shaw. With Martin, a woman who likes to walk and walk and walk, Julia Bradbury, to a man who likes to talk and talk and talk, Michael Ball. It is a surreal moment, this. People I know so well and who I've met individually, when I see you all together in the same place, it is rather a strange feeling, really, isn't it? Really? Special day today, Remembrance Day, and all with your memories, I should think, of things you've done both family-wise and as a professional, Martin. I mean, there are lots of things that make this day particularly memorable for all of us. For you?
Well, my grandfather was in the Royal Flying Corps, for a start. And secondly, I've been a pilot and flown old aeroplanes for about 30-odd years. The one that I fly at the moment was involved in D-Day and was credited with killing more German soldiers than anything else. And it was just a humble little artillery spotter, but it guided the trails onto the enemy.
Yeah, yeah. And particularly moving when you go up and somewhere like that, knowing what it had done in its past.
Yes, it is. And about a year ago, I went to Belgium and had a look at the graves there, and that was deeply, deeply moving. Mm. Far more so than I expected.
Yeah.
Because the vast majority of them say a soldier of the Great War known only to God.
Yes.
On the graves.
Yes.
And that really...
It's
going.
Such a moving phrase, that, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
Julia, remembrance memories?
My grandfather served, actually, Don Papu, as he was known, and he would always tell us stories about being a desert rat. I never quite knew what a desert rat was. He didn't see active service, but up until the day he died, hello, Don Paps, he always wore suaders, those boots from the desert, the little lace-up ankle boots. And I just remember that always about him. Whatever he was wearing, whether it was a suit or whether it was something more casual, he was our own desert rat in his suedey booties.
Michael, you've been involved in Remembrance Day commemorations quite a bit.
It's always an incredible honour when you're asked to do that. And then it's meeting the servicemen and women who are around from the past and currently serving. But during COVID, Alfie and I were asked to go to the Chelsea pensioners' hangout.
At the Royal Hospital.
And to sing there. Distance, but then we also had the Chelsea pensioners singing with us. And it's seeing those faces, seeing those guys and girls who because of them we're all right, we're here and doing what we do. So it's an honour and lovely to be part of those special occasions.
And we have a 102-year-old former RAF pilot on the programme today.
Amazing.
Flying mosquitoes, and he's been reunited with the kind of plane that he flew, so that's rather exciting.
Yeah.
But you're all quite adventurous people in your own right. Martin, as you say, you've flown, but you've also flown a Spitfire, haven't you?
Yes, not solo.
No, I've done the same in the other seat.
Yeah,
it's terribly thrilling, though.
It's incredibly thrilling, yeah. It's just one of those moments where you think, I'll never get to do this in my life.
Were you surprised how small it was? You're almost
at that. In fact, none of it really surprised me, but then having been a Spitfire buff and an aeroplane buff since I was five, I kind of knew what to expect, and I'd read so much. But really, is you don't have to fly it, you just think it, and it does it.
Mm.
It's an extraordinary aeroplane. To fly,
Julia, adventurous apart from walking? Anything dramatic?
I've done a few challenges, a few long-distance hikes and all the rest of it, and I remember a documentary that I made where I had to learn how to rock climb, properly rock climb, and the final challenge after 12 weeks of tutorage from a man called Tim Emmett, who's a rock climbing rock star, was to get to the top of a 60-metre sea stack.
Ooh.
In Scotland and, you know, make it to the top, and it took 6 hours, and... We did it.
Oh.
And I made it. And I've never, and I will never go up anything quite as treacherous and as scary again. But it was the mental challenge of getting to grips with something like that was really interesting. Yeah.
Well, that's the heroics of you two. What you might not know is that Michael has been heroic as well, because he had a great deal of struggle in a maritime situation. This is the heroic aspect of Michael Ball.
Use the rod. Keep winding. I said, it's a beauty.
Oh, no!
Oh, no!
It was huge!
It was a huge fish.
It was huge!
Yeah, but they let you think that you've got them right up to the surface.
But I did!
I know you did. And then they'll spit it out.
He was there!
And they'll go, bye-bye.
What a wind-up! That's outrageous! It was huge!
I know, that was a huge
That was dinner!
I know.
For a week!
I know. For both of us!
Yes, man!
You messed it up!
Oh!
Lesson learned! Lesson learned!
I'll have a go at anything. Yeah. Usually only once.
I've never seen you lose your cool before like that.
But we've been out there for ages catching...
Yeah, welcome to fishing.
Oh, I loved it, though. I really enjoyed it.
The thing with Michael is so withdrawn.
Very, very
introspective.
Yeah.
Michael, you've got to remember that's why they call it fishing, not catching.
Yeah, okay.
Right.
I get it.
That's the answer to it.
I get it.
Lovely to have you with us today. Thanks, all three of you, for coming. Much more from Michael, Julia and Martin coming up later. We've a war-inspired array today. Potato floddies, fruitcake. Look glorious here. Even got some fish paste sandwiches. Have you seen these? Oh, they're not curly. No, they're nice fresh ones.
Would you have wasted the crusts during the war?
No, not during the war. Waste. Well spotted,
Michael. Thank you.
Just Good remember, point. Nobody loves a smarty pants. Right. Coming up, intelligent, empathetic, hard-working, a kind expression, a good length of neck and powerful hindquarters and thighs.
It isn't
you, Michael. We're celebrating everything that's great about one of our most popular native breeds, the Highland Pony.
Ah, yes. Makes sense now.
I'll see you with the big boys, even bigger than Michael, right after this. First, the professionals, Judge John Deed, particular favourite, the Chief Inspector Gently, just some of the characters created by my next guest. When this man's on the telly, you know it's going to be worth a watch. My favourite programmes in one go, and all have stood the test of time. Maybe not the professionals, which certainly, fashion-wise, hasn't stood the test of time.
Certainly not.
You were thrust into the limelight. I mean, it made you famous very, very quickly.
Yeah, it was awkward because it was as though the career before that had vanished. And so before that, there was the Roman Polanski Macbeth, there was the National Theatre with Olivier, there was West End with Peter Hall, and then suddenly there was that, and that was all...
You might be a bit miffed. You've generally risen up in rank as you've gone on also. At least they're not going to put you back now to being a sergeant or something like that. Roles which are so varied, so different, but an awful lot of them depend entirely on chemistry with the person you're working opposite, whether it's Jenny Seagrove or Lee Ingleby in George Gently. You enjoy playing with an opposite number, it seems to me.
It's absolutely vital because, for a start, it's vital that there's no ego involved. If there's any sense of... being more important than the other one, or any sense that, we're doing that well, it's dead. And that has never, ever happened with Jenny. We've worked together for 25 years. And Lee Ingleby is just a diamond. He's one of the nicest, easiest and most talented people I've ever worked with.
I thought there were moments when he'd come out with some of those comments in George Gently, when Martin Short, great actor that he is, was having a job keeping a straight face because there were some smashing, totally inappropriate one-liners that he would come out true.
Oh, 100% true. Yeah, yeah. But we used to do it to each other, but yeah. but he more than me, because he's a very, very witty lad, and he's very spontaneous. And yeah, he had me in stitches at times.
With Jenny, you've been working together quite a bit. You did Love Letters together on the stage, and also a play, Alone Together, which went on in Windsor, and I think there might be a chance that we might see it.
Well, Alone Together, there might be a chance we see that, because we tried it out at Windsor and it was an enormous success. Love Letters, there was a bit of a surprise to everybody, because a series of letters written between a man and a woman, from the age of about 7, right the way through to the end of her life. And that's it. And the two participants sit behind a desk and read these letters. And on the face of it, you would think, oh, that's going to be a bit dull. But we put it on at Windsor after lockdown, when Windsor was dark. Then it was a huge success, and it went to the Haymarket and was a success there. And I think probably, it's as you say, it's the chemistry between Jenny and me. And we were absolutely incapable of simply reading it. And so what we did was read it, but inhabit the roles.
Yeah.
And people found it incredibly funny, incredibly moving. And I think we might do it again.
Oh, lovely. You were talking there about what you'd done before The Professionals. I mean, and obviously quite a lot afterwards. Who were the, you know, you're allowed to talk about people who are no longer with us. I mean, you worked with Olivier. I mean, who were the ones who perhaps you've learnt most from, who have impressed you, and you thought, gosh, you are good?
I think Anthony Hopkins, we were at Hornchurch Rep together. And we shared a house, and I had the little bedsit upstairs, and he had a slightly bigger one downstairs. But we shared the kitchen, and so we used to sit up late in the night talking about acting, you know. And yes, I learned a lot from him, just watching him as a remarkable actor.
And he's got on and on, being so powerful. One that you can't take your eyes off.
Absolutely.
When he's
absolutely
on.
Right.
What about Olivier?
I'll tell you a story about Olivier, which is one of the most exciting and wonderful moments that happened to me. I was at the National Theatre, and prior to that, he had done Othello, which was lauded as, quite rightly, the greatest performance of all time. And being a bit of a Stanislavski buff, as I was when I was at drama school, I went to see it, and I thought it was a brilliant impersonation, but not a great internalised performance. So roll forward about 10 years or so, and I'm at the National Theatre. And I was walking downstairs at this is when the National Theatre was at the Old Vic, and he was coming upstairs, and he paused on the landing, and he said, I couldn't play Othello anymore. And I said, oh, yeah, of course you could. And I was about to walk on, and he grabbed me by the arm, and he said, I wasn't very good in that, was I? And I thought, oh, my God, what am I going to do now? So I thought, right, I'll tell the truth, diplomatically. And I said, you were much better in the film. And he said, ah, which scene? So, right, on with the truth. I said, well, it's the death speech when the dagger came out of the bracelet and you jammed it in your neck. It's absolutely brilliant. And he leaned forward and he patted my cheek and he said, good boy.
Oh, wonderful.
Great moment.
A great moment and a great memory to have of that.
It was a diamond.
Oh, well, I'm going to take you back to an early role now. No, no, not your Shakespearean work, but work in a very famous institution.
Here we go.
Martin Shaw in Coronation Street.
You looking for the ladies' love or the gents? That's Robert, East Transcendental.
Lovely little country.
Oh, you know, pure consciousness.
Pure what, Bet?
Consciousness.
Oh.
He paints as well.
Oh, packs in some living, that kid, doesn't he?
Abstract. Landscapes. Oh, it's a great area for industrial stuff round here.
Of the soul, man. Landscapes of the soul.
Watercolours?
The indivisible colours of love.
Working with Pat Phoenix, Philip Lowry, you were Lucille Hewitt's boyfriend. Seminal, that was, I think, Martin.
I think that's the word, Alan. Yes,
I think I got the right word.
It was just so wonderful to see all of the, well, you know, be around during rehearsal with all of these icons and Violet Carson, Ina Sharples.
With
it was frightfully grand.
Really?
Oh, yes. It's entirely different.
Off. I remember seeing some awards ceremony light years ago when they were on, and all the ladies from Coronation Street turned up with fur coats. Yes. It was just terrible, sort of posh, really.
I know. Yeah. I mean, I was in the canteen and met not Ina Sharples. It was the Hilda Ogden.
Oh, yeah, yes.
I was having lunch with Hilda Ogden, and I had no idea who it was.
Jean Alexander,
yeah.
Who had quite a deep voice.
Oh, I mean, she was attractive, and she got lovely, you know, hair out here. She didn't have the headscarf on, and we were chatting away for ages, and you know. And then I saw her on the set and thought, oh, I've been talking to Hilda Ogden, you know.
Astonishing. Among those who are still with us, thankfully. Great names. I remember you in Cranford with one of our living legends. Here she is, Dame Jude. Enhanced by the music of the late, great Carl Davis. You feel power, don't you, from a performance like that when you're
acting
opposite?
Absolutely. I mean, what can you say? I mean, literally, I'm speechless.
Yeah.
For once, speechless. But when you look at somebody like that, who their entire performance, their own entire being, is their heart through their eyes and through their face, and there's nothing else to do. You just take it in and react.
Yeah.
And that's what makes her great. That's great acting.
But always looking forward, always moving on.
Oh, always, absolutely. It's not a profession where you retire willingly.
Yeah.
You know, the profession either it retires you, basically.
Yeah.
And then you think, oh, OK, that's what's happened.
Is there a Lear burning there, though, or, you know, a gigantic...?
I think so. I was offered it, and I said no. If it was offered again, I don't know, I might. It's very scary. Mm. And when people like Ian McKellen have done it, and Laurence Olivier... have done it. There is that little cowardly part of me that thinks, I don't know. But yes, it is in there. And funnily enough, a few years back, I played Hobson in Hobson's Choice.
Yeah.
And it is remarkable how similar those two plays are.
Hobson's Choice and King Lear?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yes, well, it's about his three daughters.
Yeah.
It's about a really stubborn, tortured man. And there are extraordinary parallels, and I loved playing Hobson, so maybe there's a Lear in there.
But isn't it good to be scared?
Yes. You're entirely right, and every major leap forward that I've ever done, I've started off saying no. I played Stanley Kowalski opposite Claire Bloom in Streetcar Named Desire, and when it was offered me, I said, no, I can't play Stanley Kowalski. No, I can't. Fortunately, my agent said, don't be daft, of course you can. and I did, and it moved me on. I played Lord Goring in An Ideal Husband, the Oscar Wilde play, and I said, oh, I don't know. And I did it and got nominated for a Tony and an Olivier and all that stuff.
Well, so you never learn, Martin Shaw.
No, not in that respect, you know, yeah. but I am very amenable to persuasion.
Mm. Well, just remember that when you do your King Lear, there will be a sort of spiritual hand patting you on the cheek and saying, good boy.
Oh, that's brilliant.
There you are.
Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. Delight as ever.